Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. Thank you for staying. Well, I don't have a movie, and I don't think I'm going to get promoted during this session. But I'm Eyal Desha. I've been Chief Financial Officer of Teva for the past 5 years. Actually, I've been Deputy CFO of Teva from 89 to 1996, where I went to be CFO of two other Israeli Nasdaq-listed companies, Cytex, which doesn't exist anymore, and 8 years I was the Chief Financial Officer of Checkpoint, and returned to Teva as CFO in 2008, 5 years ago. A few words about the company and where we are at this stage. As you know, Teva is a $20 billion in sales company, the largest generic manufacturer on Earth. We have 75 plants in 25 different countries around the world, 46,000 employees, over 7,000 of them are in Israel, and the rest are all over the world in 62 different countries. We are making non-GAAP profits of about $4.5 billion per year, and our cash flow from operation is a similar number, about $4.5 billion per year, and the company is in transition. 50% of Teva's sales are coming from generics, 40% of our sales are coming from specialty pharmaceuticals, and 10% from OTC products and a few other areas. The company has presented to the stock market last December a new strategic plan focusing on generics with expansion in emerging market, specialty pharmaceutical focusing on four major areas, the central nervous system, what we call CNS, or neuroscience, respiratory diseases and their solutions, oncology, and women health. In addition to that, we do have a number of additional products which are currently either sold or are under development in a variety of therapeutic segments. Teva is investing about $1.5 billion every year in research and development, developing a very large and diversified pipeline of products that will come to market between 2013. Some of our new products will be launched towards the end of this year, and 7 or 8 years going forward. Sorry, and of course we have an active research and business development activity in order to identify and discover the future product of Teva that will come to market, and the next wave, and the next wave. This is how pharmaceutical companies are building their future. So the company today is actively developing new products, searching for additional products outside and inside in our labs, and in addition is engaged in a wonderful joint venture collaboration with Procter & Gamble on selling over-the-counter products, which are products that are sold without prescription all over the world. A very, very good, interesting, fast-growing partnership that that started in November 2011, so it's a little more than a year and a half ago, and is growing very strong. The company is now led by Dr. Jeremy Levin, our new CEO as of a year ago. Relatively new management team. If we look at the transition and the changes, only three of our top management members have been in their current positions at the beginning of 2012. I'm one of them. The others were either promoted from within, changed role, or recruited from the outside. We recruited a number of top pharmaceutical executives also from the outside. Great addition to the management team. And the company is running fast, working hard, and very, very energetic on building its business. I will allow Roy, who has a list of questions. Thank you very much for doing this. Roy Navon, heading the Israeli operation of JP Morgan Chase. I hope I described you correctly. And he volunteered to ask a few questions that may be of interest to all of you.
So thank you. Thank you for hosting me here. Thank you for the Value Stock Exchange for this opportunity. Eyal, maybe we start with yesterday's news. You announced a large settlement. Took investors by surprise, so certainly the investors out there be curious to hear what you could add around the close to over $900 million of additional payment beyond what you had reserved for.
Yeah. Well, let me tell you something, a little story. Rui and I met on the El Al flight yesterday. That landed in the afternoon in London, and we were standing next to the kitchen or the toilet, depending on your preference, and chatting about his list of questions. And I told him, listen, well, tomorrow you're gonna have a completely new list of questions. That's okay. And he didn't know what I was talking about. I did know, and exactly when we landed, we published the news on this settlement. Well, it's a very large settlement, $1.6 billion going to the wrong direction. Nobody is, that's definitely not people having my role, could be happy about this. But it was inevitable. The trial has been going on since the beginning of 2008. When we launched a product, a very meaningful large product, at the end of 2007, believing in basing this on a legal opinion and a judge opinion that we received prior to that, that we are not infringing the patent of the innovator, which was then Wyatt, subsequently acquired by Pfizer, which was the largest pharmaceutical company in the world until recently. We believe that we are not infringing. It went to a long legal process, including two jury trials in the United States. And those of you who are familiar with the U.S. legal system, jury trials and their results are highly unpredictable. So the first jury decided that we did infringe, and the second jury had the assignment of determining the damages. The maximum damage was $2.7 billion that we could have paid, and you manage your risk. Both sides are managing the risk, and we decided to settle. When we look at this, as overall, it's more or less a zero-sum game. We made money. We will pay money. We have an insurance policy that will cover, hopefully, when we see the money from the insurance, about $500 million. So the total, we got money up front, and we have to pay it. But that wasn't the intention. We believe that that was the right business move to do, but the court had a different opinion, and we have to bear with that. So we got the cash up front. We'll have to pay it out. We'll pay $800 million this year, another $800 million in 2014, and we'll put this behind us. It's been lingering for quite some time. Very, very well disclosed in our financial statement. Outcome was always unpredictable. It is what it is.
So coming back to Teva as the anchor of success stories among the great companies that have presented here this morning, certainly nobody stands out like Teva in terms of the long-term sustainable growth. You've done it through generics. You've done it through CNS products. You've done it through mergers and acquisitions, and there's a new strategy in place. What can you tell us about the key tenets of sustainable growth going forward? You've talked about, and Jeremy's talked about, the fact that you will shift the focus away from large acquisitions. So what will be the key tenets of sustainable growth from here on?
Yeah, we believe, and please don't take this as a promise, because life is dynamic in our industry and things could change. But we believe that the period of the mega acquisition for Teva are over. This period is over for a while, and that we will focus on building our pipeline, penetrating new geographies, focusing on generic growth in emerging market, and bringing new product, whether they are a generic product or specialty product, bringing them to market. When you look at companies and how they manage their growth, obviously there are two ways to grow the business, either organically or by way of acquisition. It's very difficult, not impossible, but it is very difficult to do both at the same time. And management focus on acquisition and integrating the acquisition and making the new combined company work is in many cases, distracting attention from organic growth. And we believe that organic growth is in our industry is the biggest value creator. Growing by acquisition is a legitimate way. There's a lot of cheap money in the world right now. But our strategy will focus on smaller acquisition, on acquisitions which are designed either to build our future pipeline or to expand our presence mostly in emerging economies like Asia, like Latin America, like Africa, which will take at least 5 years to start to grow, but maybe that's the right time to invest there, and less on the very large acquisition that requires deployment of a lot of money on one hand and consumes enormous management attention on the other hand. We are focusing on organic growth and growing our business organically. We believe we'll deliver the shareholder value that everybody is expecting Teva to deliver over the past 2 to 3 years.
So this question of how you grow organically versus acquisitions really part of a capital allocation question. So if you de-emphasize large acquisitions, and certainly with a very robust cash flow that you all generate, what are the implications? We've seen you more focused on buybacks and dividends. What can you tell us about your capital strategy going forward?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, capital allocation is the mirror image of the strategy. If you go back and look at the period where Teva made large acquisition, dividend payments were not very high, and there was no buyback. I mentioned before, we generate $4.5 billion of cash flow from operation every year, and that's a lot of money to allocate. Given this new focus and strategic approach, we are increasing our dividend. We are buying back more shares. We bought back $1.1 billion of shares in 2012, when we are continuing to manage the buyback program in 2013, as we have already reported, and we'll continue to do so. So we do have more cash to allocate toward giving it back to shareholders and building shareholder value in a different way, using a different balance. Because at the end of the day, you know, even with these large amounts, cash is limited. And we believe that the balance of allocating cash today is the right balance to create maximum value to our shareholders. And it will take more time, there's no doubt about it. But I believe that we're doing the right thing. We have debt portfolio to manage, and we manage this in a very responsible way. We have dividend payments to make to our shareholders. We believe that at the current share price, buyback is the right economic investment, but we also want to keep money in order to be able to conduct some business development activities which are particularly attractive and will build value over time. So yes, there is a mix here of using cash, and we're managing and monitoring this very, very carefully.
Another aspect of your profitability comes from your cost base, and you've had a recent announcement of a fairly large restructuring and cost-cutting exercise. How's that going? Can you give the investors an update on your plans with that?
We have created a plan which we call Reshape. To reshape the company, it's not just about cost-cutting or cost-based reduction. It's also maybe first and foremost about how the company is managed, where decisions are being made, what is the span of control. and how organizationally we're structured, this is driving the cost. This is the real driver behind our cost base. And the plan will result in $1.5 to $2 billion of cost-based reduction in 5 years. Most of this will happen in year two and year three of the plan, which means 2014 and 2015. It is based on different way of procuring. It is based on different processes of management. It is based on reducing our cost of goods sold by about $1 billion over this period of time by shutting down inefficient plants in expensive locations and moving production to the more efficient parts of our production network in low-cost locations. So you can see us producing less in the United States than in Western Europe and more in Eastern Europe and in India.
This is also an Israel-based conference, so let's talk a little bit about the importance of the DNA of Teva as an Israeli company. And then, you know, taking another step back, your career spanned many companies amongst the leading companies in Israel, from being a banker to being in a technology company, Teva, and back to technology and back to Teva. What are your observations around being able to create more multi-billion dollar companies listed on the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange and generally being part of the Israeli economy?
Well, thank you for the questions. We contemplated it on the flight. But thank you for the question anyway. First of all, I think is that the Israeli capital market is very important. Let's start from that. And continue to build it and creating the right conditions for vibrant, liquid, sophisticated capital market in Israel is extremely important, and by the way, an open one as well. Teva is dual listed. We're listed on the New York Stock Exchange and on Tel Aviv Stock Exchange. Actually, I believe that the original Teva listed on Tel Aviv Stock Exchange in 1951. That was even before even I was born. And we're happy with that. We're happy. There's a lot of liquidity in the stock. Volatility is reasonable. Sometimes Israeli investors tend to jump the gun, but in most cases they do the right things. We have a very long trading day, which means more headache for someone like me, but that it is coming with the territory. So starts in the morning in Israel and ends at 11 p.m. Israel time in the United States, but that's okay. I think it's an asset. I think it has value, and we do operate under a dual listing law that makes our life fairly easy and simple, because we follow the U.S. Security laws and the Israeli law when it comes to dual listed company is accepting the fact that there is only one set of rules and laws that govern. It worked well. Haven't seen any conflict about this. So I do believe that it is important that the Israeli capital market will grow. I think that the government has a few things to do about this, and their influence and intervention and creating the right tax environment as well as the right liquidity environment is important. And I know and I hope that they are really minding about it when they will finish to pass the new budget. They will take the time also to take a close look at building the right financial environment. Speaking about Israeli companies, well, Teva, in a way against all odds, managed to create the largest generic company in the universe from a very small home-based market. There are very few examples parallel to that. Even Nokia, which was founded in Finland, based its early years on the Scandinavian cellular market, which was at that time the leader in the world And if you remember, there was also another company called Ericsson that came out of there. But that's another example of a global leader coming out of a small home-based market. You have to be able to sell in your market in order to create the right cash flow and drive and infrastructure to grow overseas. Teva didn't have that. But this is a story of unique vision and leadership of one man. His name is Eli Horowitz, who passed away last year. And his courage and imagination and strategic vision created and brought Teva to what it is. I believe that this, you call the DNA, this entrepreneurial spirit, type of leadership, is indeed embedded in the in the Israeli business DNA. And we've seen a number of examples. I hope we'll be able to see more. I mentioned before I was privileged to serve on three of these companies. Cytex, who was founded by another unique leader, Effie Arazi, who passed away last month, at the late 60s. And Checkpoint, which was founded by Gil Shwed. Again, a man with a mission, a man with a vision. In 1993, and created the biggest network security company and the technology leader in the world. I believe there are other leaders like that in Israel. Some of them are leading smaller companies today. They will grow. Some of them are still in high school or serving in the military, which is, by the way, the Israeli Army is probably the biggest incubator for leaders and for technology. And when we talk about Startup Nation, and you want to really understand the roots, it's in the Israeli Army. And that the technology training that many, many young people get when they serve there. And then they come out with the ideas, with the feeling that they can do everything. Well, some fall on their face, but many are successful. The tendency to take risks and the ability to execute, you see how things do happen. And I think that is the very special, that secret sauce that Israeli companies had, and I think that there are a lot of that is in Teva. And Teva's Israeli identity, origins, and sources are unique, are important, but I think we could not, and the Teva's leaders of the past and the present, could not have built and managed such a large multinational company without being able to recruit the best talent overseas. We can't do it based on Israelis alone. Teva's management today have about half of it comprised of Israelis and the other half of non-Israelis, some of the best leaders in our industry. And we managed to recruit them, to bring them to work in harmony as one company. And I think that is the secret of Teva's growth and success, and success today. The ability to maintain its leadership position depends not only on the Israeli spirit, but also on the ability to recruit and work in harmony with people from Europe, people from US, people from Asia, Japan. And that is the secret. If I can offer advice to Israeli companies, there are two types. Ones which are built to exit. Many of us will follow the story of Waze. Yesterday, by the way, it works very well here in London. Sold to Google for over $1 billion. Sure, that's an application that was built for an exit because it cannot survive in an isolated environment. It has to be a part of a bigger thing. And it's legitimate. Now, some Israelis are very critical of the exit culture. Nothing wrong with that. Not every idea will survive. And by the way, it's the same thing for biotech. Small companies developing a new molecule or a biologic product will not have the ability to bring it to market, because they can't sell it, they don't have feet on the street, and they will never have the capital to invest in a phase three clinical trial that could cost up to $500 million. They need to be a part of a bigger thing. But there are also companies in Israel, and I'm familiar with a number of them, who are real companies with products, with a business model that is sustainable. You sell a product, and then you sell, if it's software, we sell the maintenance of our product. If it's 3D printing, you sell the printer, and then you sell the consumables. So you have repetitive transaction again and again. That's the way to build companies which are not for exit, which are sustainable to stay and to grow. And there are a number of products like this, companies like this in Israel. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Stratasys. Stratasys is a merger of an Israeli company from Rehovot and an American company from Minneapolis, who created the largest producer of 3D printers in the world. The company with market cap of $3 billion and sales that will probably be close to $500 million in 2015. And it is an Israeli company, very well kept secret, listed on NASDAQ. So we have companies like this as well, with sustainable models to continue and grow and bring that unique spirit of the Israeli entrepreneurs to the world.
Certainly those of us like you and I that live in this economy, you serve on multiple boards, and I speak to many of these as a banker, all appreciate that and just are reminded every day how incredible of an environment we live and operate in the Israeli market. And as much as I have a pleasure to continue asking you questions, I do want to give the audience an opportunity to ask a couple of questions before you run out of time.
I should say that we are pretty much out of time, so we've probably got time for just one question. If someone's really itching to ask Eyal a question, then make it a short one, and then we can finish on time. Anyone? No, looks like Roy has managed to ask all of the questions that everyone else could ask. And for those of you that don't know, I did a piece on Teva. I was terribly ill the day I went there, ironically enough. And I was intrigued to discover that this company, if you want to know how long it takes to build a company of this size, 1903, I think it was, from delivering drugs on camelback. And I was going to go try and film outside the original place where Teva began, but I was told it was a little bit too inner, perhaps not the best part of town where I should be doing that in Jerusalem, I think it is. But anyway, I just want to thank our final panelists here, Eyal Desher and Roy Navon from JP Morgan. We give them a round of applause.
Thank you very much.